Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gabriella Mingoia. I am one of the education fellows here at Berkeley Rep. And I would love to invite up the next panelists for the panel identifying the intersections. So if I could have Elyse Klaidman, Nora Merecicky, Sean Orlando, and Joël Tan. Hello. First of all, it's really nice to meet most of you. I know Nora, but I haven't met three of you yet. It's a pleasure. Welcome. So today we're going to talk about identifying the intersections, and this is a topic as a young professional myself or an aspiring professional that I feel really interested in, because in today's job landscape, like the last panel was describing, it seems very hybrid and very fluid, and that employees need to be multifaceted and multidisciplinary. So when thinking about identifying the intersections, what does that mean for you as a professional? Nora, want to start?
I think this is probably something that's going to come up through all of the panels today, just, you know, being flexible and finding a way to sort of tell your own story and communicate in a way that makes your experiences understandable and relevant to whatever you're looking to do in the future. So understanding that, you know, arts organizations need administrators and IT people, and I'm a graphic designer, so I can kind of apply my skills to, you know, pretty much any company needs a graphic designer. But communicating, hey, I have this, I'm coming in with these experiences. Here's how I can help you. What can I do to help you? So I think finding that balance.
It's interesting. I didn't really ever know what I wanted to be when I grew up. I think I wanted to be an astronaut at some point, of course, but what little kid didn't. But I knew that I wanted to be an artist. I knew that, and I think my mother clued into that, because I just kept taking things apart in the house just to figure out how they worked. So I had this intense curiosity for the world and for how things worked, how things were put together and functioned. And I think it's important to always be open to learning, be flexible in how you approach any subject matter. It's hard for me to say exactly what I do when I don't know if this is the case for many of you, but when I go to fill out forms online or in person, I have to choose other as my profession, because there's never a box that says artist, and I'd love to see that change. But I'm an artist. I work with collaboratively with large groups of people, a diverse group of artists, to create large-scale sculptures and installations. But I'm also a project manager, a production coordinator, an event coordinator, and I find the most joy in maintaining diversity in my work. It's really interesting to me, and it's always really interesting to learn the processes and how to create something, but then and through the people that you're working with.
Yeah, I would say similarly. I always knew I wanted to be an artist, but I had no idea what form that would take. And I think for me, one of the most important things has been two things: always following my passion, but also always being completely open to opportunities. And as an artist, you have to make a living, right? So there's all kinds of jobs that come your way, and you have to evaluate them. Is this going to engage me creatively? Is this going to pay my bills? Will I learn something from this job? And I could never go the route of being a waitress, not because I don't have huge respect for that. I kind of always wanted to be one. It looked like it was a really sexy job, but I never did that. But I always took jobs that had something, even if it wasn't necessarily being a painter in that moment, but that engaged me intellectually and creatively, where I knew I was going to learn something. And it led me down paths that I couldn't have predicted, and I couldn't have predicted where ultimately I ended up. So I did a lot of teaching, and I worked in galleries and ran galleries, and I ended up at Pixar because I was able to teach. That was what I was hired for, and ended up doing things that have involved all of my kind of past weird jobs. And, you know, I had no idea, but the one consistent was I was making art and I was following things that made me feel excited.
I'm Joël Tan, and I've been the director of community engagement at YBCA for the last decade. And so I say that to address terminology, because I always want to start off, in order to address identifying the intersections, I think I need to make a delineation between the job and work. Because the work that I do can manifest in terms of jobs, it can manifest in terms of independent projects or radical collaborations. But ultimately, let me take it down to the most literal, in that the intersection that I occupy is such that I worked 16 years in public health prior to my work as an arts professional. And much of what I learned in public health, and specifically developing HIV/AIDS prevention education programs for communities of color, that work, not only the pedagogies and the strategies that I learned in public health have been applicable to and translatable to the arts sector, but most importantly, and this is what Susie was saying, the discipline that you pick up in that particular sector, along with the values that inform the discipline, the approach, the way you go about it, has created an exciting, radical combination with arts pedagogy. So I'm really excited that there's somebody here, this young woman who's interested in economics, because what we need, I believe, in the arts sector in the present future are people who have an economics brain, along with other brains, to do this very amazing work with arts engagement, because we're just starting to find out what arts can really do, and it's going to require other skills, other sectors, and identification of other superpowers to unlock it.
I think we're also at a time where people are finally starting to realize that the arts need to be at the table with technology, with leadership, with economics, that the arts are equal partners. I mean, and it's slow. We're climbing that ladder. But truly, if you look at what's going on out there, art and technology, leadership, economics, they're like this. The businesses that are working are the ones that embrace that.
You both just brought up a perfect segue, actually. So I would like each of you to touch on that moment when you identified that intersection in your career. So think about your current job now, and how is it a blend of all of your varied past experiences? And in those past experiences, was there a moment where you said, hey, now I want to go this direction, and this is the step I can take to get there?
I studied graphic design in school and had kind of a couple moments where I was lucky enough to have a work-study job designing for the local small art museum on campus, where I kind of realized, oh, I can design for this sort of greater cause that I really believe in. That's really great. I'm not sure if I'll be able to do that in the real world, but I'm glad I can do this now. And then, I don't know, I tell this, what I call the Febreze story. We, my classmates and I went to visit a big branding agency in Cincinnati, Ohio, and, you know, they work on, like, Procter & Gamble and, like, Kraft and, you know, every huge brand, and we're hearing from alumni from my school who, you know, had been designing Febreze cans for, like, 2 years or something. And that was a moment where I was like, oh no, I'm gonna end up here and my soul's gonna die. So I think that was a moment where I really kind of committed myself to, okay, I need to make this art museum thing work. Like I need to use my skills for this good stuff and not like designing like toothpaste tubes or whatever. So I furiously applied to many, many internships at different, mostly museums all around the country. Ended up getting a fellowship at Berkeley Repertory Theater, which was an amazing experience that I'm sure we'll go into more detail later on the later panel. After that, I was hired at a social change communications agency in San Francisco called Fenton. And that's a for-profit company. It's very fast-paced client work. So I was working for clients in healthcare, environment, social justice, women's issues, not a lot of art, but not a lot of sort of like art sector issues. But working in an environment like that, at an agency where you get to work with five completely different clients every day, you kind of learn a lot about what direction it is that you want to go in. And you know, picking up all these different little tidbits along the way, you get a taste of everything. And so I think the common thread there, though, was that our goal was to tell our clients' stories. And that's what Berkeley Rep does, too. I ended up having the opportunity to come back to Berkeley Rep as the art director, and it's kind of, I see that as sort of the common, as the intersection in my career, I guess, as, you know, help. How can I use my skills to help other people tell their stories? That's my own personal experience.
I think I would encourage you to travel and to take a different path. And that meaning that when I was growing up, I was drawing all the time and. I was an artistic little retarded kid, and people always tried to discourage me from becoming an artist because it wasn't back then seen as a viable career path. But I resisted that, and I decided that in my teens that I decided that I wasn't ready to immerse myself into a college experience, live on the campus and the dorms and that whole thing. It repelled me for some reason. So I decided to. Not go to college, which I don't encourage you all to do, but instead I traveled, and I traveled to Europe, I went to South America, I traveled cross country multiple times, experienced different cultures, languages, museums, art from those countries, and it was one of the most amazing experiences I've ever had, and it really helped guide me to where I am now. And I did end up going back to college at a later age, in my 30s, to get my bachelor's at UC Berkeley in the practice of art. And that was also extremely rewarding. I was focused at that time and knew exactly what I wanted to do. And back when in my teens, I didn't quite know. So I think that it all started to come around for me when I discovered, I moved out to California, and I discovered this really vibrant, diverse arts community out in Oakland, and specifically in West Oakland. And I'd found out about the Crucible in West Oakland and went to a lecture on Albert Paley, and it was amazing. It just opened my eyes to a whole world of fabrication and art and the tactile arts and sculpture, and I ended up volunteering there, and then they hired me, and then I worked as a studio manager, and then I ended up teaching classes there to kids on how to fabricate, and I immersed myself in that community, that creative artistic community, and it changed my life. And eventually I worked my way into events production, and that opened up my world professionally, because it challenged me to organize myself, to be strategic, to figure, you know, learn Excel and the Word documents, but to be very organized and to work on budgets and and it helped me to manage large groups of people. When you're working on events, I did all of their fire arts festivals and operas and ballets and theatrical productions, and there's a large, diverse, ego-driven community of people who are working on these projects, and I learned how to manage and work with a large group of people collaboratively on a large creative project, and that translated to my current job at the Exploratorium as production coordinator, working on all of our major adult theme programs, After Darks, and temporal based programs, and I do that as a living now, and it's a creative environment working with artists and physicists and scientists and creative thinkers, and it's my job to organize, to create a structure around that, to create an event, and it is the most satisfying thing I've ever done in my life, I think. And in contrast to that, I started. I still had this artistic urge, this urge to create with my hands, and so I came up with an idea to make a large scale collaborative group project. The problem was I didn't know anybody to build it with me, so I started putting word out and collected and gathered this amazing group of artists from all over the Bay Area, and we built this 40-foot tall sculpture. And it was the beginning of this group of artists, Five-Ton Crane, of which Colin Babcock, who's speaking in the next panel, is a member of, that has worked on several large and small-scale projects over the years. And we don't do it for money. We do it for the pure satisfaction of working creatively together. And in my position as an organizer, event organizer, event curator and coordinator, it's been really essential to have those organizational skills in order to manage a large group of people on a large project with six-figure budgets. And at the same time, what I found to be key is to try your best to remove the ego from the project that you're working on, whatever it is, because it's not just about you. I might have come up with the idea, but it's the group that's building it, that's conceiving of it, and that's actualizing it. And so if you can remove ego from the equation, it's a much more satisfying experience for everyone involved. And everyone can have a sense of ownership of that project, whether it's a theatrical production or a sculpture or an organization. I find that's very important.
I think you can avoid the intersection. I mean, I don't know how that's even possible. Right? Even in your studio, alone by yourself, you're doing research, whether it's on materials or images or traveling. I mean, you're constantly, you have to interact with other aspects of the world to be an interesting artist. But then in terms of every kind of work that you do, I mean, in terms of my path, teaching, the first grown-up job post-college was teaching in a school for learning disabled kids. And it was a school that used the arts to reach students and teach traditional skills, reading and math and history, but also to broaden and teach artistic skills. And in doing that, one, you're learning from the students constantly, because probably that's where I learn the most from anybody who's wanting to learn, from kids. But you're also learning how to communicate. You're learning how to work with groups. You're learning how to suss out strengths and weaknesses and teach to the strengths and support the weaknesses. In my world, in the gallery world, I was running a gallery for contemporary Latin American artists and having to work with artists from all over Latin America and learning in order to work with them about the issues that they brought from their countries, from their experience. I think travel is a hugely important part of remaining open and flexible and being able to see the world through many, many eyes. And, you know, by pure coincidence and stroke of luck, I ended up at Pixar, which is a place that it wouldn't exist without a collaboration between art and technology, traditional filmmaking, business leaders. You know, it takes all kinds to work on that collaborative art project. And what's exciting about it is that you are constantly becoming better at something. You're constantly learning and, again, seeing it from a different perspective. And, you know, a lot of what I'm doing these days has to do with leading a group of people. And had anyone ever said to me, you know, you're going to be a leader, like, are you crazy? I mean, why would I do that? I'm not interested. I wouldn't be good at it. But actually, I've found it to be as creative as anything else I've done, because you're working with people who are full of ideas, and your job as a leader is to mentor, enable, support, give the resources for incredible art and collaboration to happen. So for me, the intersections are, they're everywhere. And everything that I've done leads to my ability to support the people I work with.
I take it as a personal challenge to live my life in such a way that eventually my family, my immigrant Filipino family, can explain what I do. It's really key, right? Like, what is it that you... When I was working in public health, you could ask my tia and she'll say, he's working to fight to end AIDS. Very clear. And now I keep thinking about, well, okay, that was the work that I did. And remember the delineation that I make between what my work is, which is what my mission, kind of what this mission statement is for my life, my incarnation, and my jobs, and how jobs manifest the work. So I think that the work that I do is try to understand myself deeply and how I'm evolving, which then tells me what my work is. Because from that place, I can start to assess what is it that I'm good at? What is it that I'm interested in? Based on the past, how is it that I've been able to contribute? And to take it away from at least the thinking of sectors. Like for me, I don't necessarily want, I hear the impulse and I respect it. I don't want an artist box. Because to a certain extent, it's in part driven by my background. I think many of us here grew up either in generations or in cultures where art wasn't seen as a viable vocation, right? We grew up with that idea. But I keep thinking, you know, what it is now isn't a box. What it is now, I think particularly in a world where we, Facebook, social, we're constantly talking about who we are, right? Social, Facebook, Twitter, it's your mission statement is always happening. So we're in that world. So what does that mean? Who are you going to be in this life? And you're also living much longer. We're going to be living much longer, so ideas about career is already changing right beneath your feet. Your retirement age is changing. Your idea of careers is changing. So to that, if we're living much longer and we're going to have different careers, what is your mission statement? What are you good at? What are you inclined to? So to that end, I would say that having worked in HIV/AIDS, I did it as an artist. We did this in the late 80s, early 90s, and when I say we, the AIDS movement was built and founded by artists in all major cities. The early organizers of AIDS work were artists. So to that end, I want to revisit that AIDS history and say, who here knows the term social practice in the arts? It's arguable that HIV/AIDS, in the way it developed, was a huge social practice initiative, because a lot of the innovation, a lot of the strategies, a lot of the aesthetics that have emerged from AIDS and it still keeps giving was generated by artists. And it wasn't just artists as in the vocation, it's almost like the gas, the spirit that wanted to hack or solve this big pandemic, and how did we do it? And it is no coincidence that it is a group of creative people that did that. And those people, some of them are still working in AIDS, some of them have moved on, but their work is still the same. Their work is still the same while their jobs have changed.
I heard a really wonderful thing in there about how the term career is going to change. And so essentially, we could, as young professionals, have, you know, 5 to 6 to 7 different careers in our lives. So hypothetically, if you were to move into a different field or a different organization, what skills would you highlight when moving towards that field?
Great.
Yeah. Anyone can start.
What skills would we highlight to move into another field?
Yeah. If we were to move into a different field.
I can share how I got my job coming from public health. And it was an adventure. I got my job 10 years ago when there wasn't community engagement in the discussion in the arts. It was only 10 years ago. While community engagement was always happening in the arts, the term community engagement was new. It was a paradigm shift that we were at one point art centers had education. The approach was there's the art, there's the themes and motifs, and we will educate our publics about this. Well, the new paradigm says, all right, we're not just doing this kind of like top-down education, it's engagement. All right, so community engagement. So 10 years ago, nobody knew what the term community engagement was as a professional. It's just a job title. So one, it already worked for me because we didn't know what it was yet. It was still kind of ambivalent. I know that I work really well in the gray. I ran into the job posting because while I worked in HIV/AIDS for 16 years, I never stopped my arts practice. In fact, I actively published, put up exhibitions, created performances while I was working in AIDS. So that never stopped, so I was always connected to the arts community. Well, this director of community engagement posting came up. Now, it's important for you to know that in the 16 years I was doing AIDS work, from the beginning, I've always said, I'm an artist, because I actually gave up a Parsons scholarship. And I told my mom, I'm doing this because there's an epidemic. And how can I go to art school when there's something else more important happening in the world? So I did that. I told my immigrant mother that I was going to give up my scholarship. And I had to answer, why did we move to this country so you could do this, right? So in that, I went into AIDS work in the first year saying, you know what, this is important work, but when I finally retire from AIDS work, when this thing is over, I'm going to get a fat job in the arts. I said it every year. I said it regularly. Reality creation works. You must say it. You must believe it, you must do it, you must envision it. So it was the confluence of all those things, and this director of community engagement posting came up. I've been working in the field for 16 years now, and I saw it. I saw how great it was, and I thought about all the work, all of the skills, and all of the organizing, and more importantly, the strategies and values that I basically picked up and developed in my 16 years, and I saw immediately how translatable they were. Because I thought to myself, all of my education programs that I developed in AIDS are art-based. Most education programs that work in public health, in social justice, are arts-based. I will make that argument. So, at the end of the day, the director that hired me, fortunately for me, he was also the president of the board of the Tucson AIDS Project in a past job. So when I told him all of my community engagement strategies in public health were art-based, he believed me. He could see it. He knew how it happens. And his argument for hiring me was, if he can create effective programs for immigrant communities, for communities of color, how hard of a sell can art be? Because it didn't have that additional pressure of, you know, of changing epidemiology through arts engagement. He was only part right. It was very exciting to translate a lot of the strategies and values, and many of our programs, I think, are rooted in public health strategies and values. But at the same time, it took me 10 years. It was a real learning curve to integrate into another sector. So it's not, you come with your superpowers, but I've had to learn that you also had to come with the humility that it's, you're still new, you still need, hazing still happens no matter what. A learning curve is still in front of you. So it's, I think, a combination of those two things about, one, being able to deeply connect to what your mission is, to know how to present that in the world, but then also to, you know, if you're shifting between worlds, is to have strategies and the kind of frame of mind to humble yourself, to know that there's a learning curve in front of you, and to find different ways to negotiate that.
I think if I were gonna want one of the skills to carry through to the next career that I would recommend is self-awareness,
yeah,
and ability to communicate, to actually to listen. I think it's really easy when we're trying to get jobs to talk all about ourselves, and I did this and I did that, and to actually know who you're speaking to be genuinely interested, and to actually hear, yeah, not pretend you're listening so that you could quickly say something, but to listen. Because the more I do that, again, the more I learn, the more aware of myself and how I get in my own way by, you know, sometimes good things. I'm enthusiastic, so I want to make things happen and do them quickly and finish. And that's stepping on other people sometimes. It's not fully sitting with an idea to really understand what it is and what the impact it could have, or who I could be collaborating with, or who has a way better idea than my mm-hmm. idea, or how my idea married to someone else's idea with another one added to it is better than any of us could have dreamed. So I think those skills, which I've learned probably later in life more and more, are the most valuable ones.
Yeah, I agree. Being able to listen, not just be the center of the room, the center of attention, but to be open to other people's ideas, and to maintain a patience throughout, to maintain your thirst for knowledge, because that's what you're doing when you're listening to other people, is you're learning from them, and that adds to your experience and your knowledge, and maintain the hunger to live and breathe an arts lifestyle. There are all different career paths you can take in the arts. When I was a young artist, I was dirt poor, eating top ramen, and had change in my pockets. It was a struggle, and there will always be struggling times, but you have to persevere. You have to maintain your a strong desire to follow through on your dream. And I went from a starving artist to getting my first commissions to do public art with six-figure budgets, and that was massive for me. And so you never know which direction you can go, and you just have to be open to the possibilities.
I would just reiterate and wholeheartedly agree with the communication, having the skills, again, to just kind of tell your own story in a way that's going to be meaningful for that other person. And a lot, you know, this idea that comes with listening is, you know, asking questions. What can I do? How can I help with this? You know, what do you need versus here's why I'm the best person for this, kind of just enhances that further engagement. And just being brave, because I think a lot of it is, you know, taking a risk and jumping into something you're not sure if you're ready to do, you're not sure if you're qualified to do it. You know, I've been there, and if you've got the drive and the passion for it and you care about it, a lot of times that's more important than, oh, I've had XYZ management experience or whatever, so.
Thing, just going back to listening and communication, it's really, really hard to, because you're struggling with wanting people to know that you're really good at what you do, right? Wanting people mm-hmm. to know that there's a reason they should hire you or give you this next project. And so the battle between sitting back and quietly enabling others and supporting versus the like desire to say, well, they really did well at that because I told them how, and I helped them, and I supported them. I mean, I struggle with that every day because, you know, you want to get a pat on the back sometimes. You want people to think you're great. But if you sit back, they know. It pays off, but it isn't easy.
Mm-hmm. So, Elyse, you were mentioning that as an artist, you have found those intersections, that they're just everywhere. And everyone's mentioned just being open to those intersections and being brave and jumping into the the next thing. What about people who are not in the arts and they're looking to have a career in the arts? What would you say would be the first step?
So they're currently not in the arts, but that's their goal. They'd like to get to mm-hmm. the arts. I mean, I guess to stop and think about what is it that you are passionate about, as we've all said, what is it that you do well, right? And how can that amplify or plus something out there? So if you're passionate about music, right, and you've listened to it your whole life, and you look for an organization that somehow is involved in music, but you realize you're actually a really organized person. You're great at putting stuff in categories. You're great at, you know, whatever it is, look to those organizations that have something that you're passionate about and apply your skills, your depth and breadth of talent.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are lots of organizations you can involve yourself in order to immerse yourself in the work that they do. For us, Colin and I, with Five Ton Crane, there are probably 140 members, and a number of them work at Berkeley Rep, a number of them work at Pixar. Lauren Carpenter, who is chief engineer, was chief engineer at Pixar, is a member, and many of the people who came to work on the projects that we initiated weren't self-proclaimed artists. They were programmers or chief financial officers or carpenters, builders, economists, and they got in there and they used the skills that they had in order to contribute to the project that we were working on collaboratively. And in that process, they learned electronics or how to weld or how to work aluminum or how to conceive of a certain aspect of the project. And in that way, in being involved in that immersive environment, then you learn what it means to make and how to think creatively and how to come up with creative solutions for complex problems, and that can be really critical when you're working in any artistic medium.
Lauren Carpenter is an amazing example because he's a brilliant scientist and engineer who was one of the founding members of Pixar, who created the technology that's now used all over the world and has been going to Burning Man since it started, working on unbelievable collaborative projects.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when we created a submarine in 2011 and he helped create the interface on the iPad that was incorporated into the dashboard of the submarine that would control the various GPS systems that we had built into the submarine. I mean, it's just crazy. But you know that he's I think he'll refer to himself as an artist, but he's a very brilliant engineer and scientist.
I think step one is just kind of knowing and recognizing that these jobs are out there. They exist. It's not, you know, a pie in the sky dream. It doesn't have to be completely separate from your personal passion. So, you know, knowing that it's out there, you, and that you have a role you can play, kind of no matter what your background is. And going out and meeting people, going out and, you know, reaching out to people at, you know, organizations or that you particularly admire. I think kind of like getting to know the people, I guess I would say, in the arts community and starting to create a network is always super important, because, you know, people like to hire people they know. That's reality. Or, you know, being just presenting yourself as someone who, oh, I would enjoy working with this person, you know, even if I'm not really sure, like, I don't understand exactly what they did before, but this person is really great. They'd be a great part of our team. So those are some thoughts.
It's a lot about relationships. The last three jobs that I've gotten is because I knew the person that I had the interview with, that was hiring for the position. And I had the experience, but I was up against 50 other applicants. And, but because from a previous engagement with them and relationship with them, it helped. You know, they didn't rubber stamp me, of course. I had to fight for each position, but it helps to have good working relationships with people in all different areas, because you never know when it's going to come around and benefit you in another more amazing way.
If I were to think about somebody in not in arts moving into the arts, makes me think about, my husband and I are thinking about moving to Hawaii, right? And I think about it, and we go there more and more, you know, within a year we'll go twice, three times now, more and more. And every time we go there, I think about, like, what does it mean for us to move here? It used to be that, like, look at all the things that I can get by living in Hawaii. Amazing nature, amazing all this. And the more we visit, the more it becomes, okay, if we're really going to do this, what does the community we're interested in really need? What is it really there? If it's a lived reality, if somebody moving into the arts, like, well, what does it really need? And what, and more importantly, what can we contribute to that if we're going to be there in any kind of real, sustainable way? I would probably think in the same way about moving into the arts, because current, and I would encourage it, actually. I would encourage non-arts folks who have a calling or an inkling to move into the arts because they know, you know, with a general idea of what they could contribute, because the arts is in a time right now where that's needed, where other expertise is needed, because the arts sector on its own is a dying planet. And we need to have ideas, we need to have other expertise from other sectors, so that art centers and the way they're evolving can find find its evolution in this new time. Like, how can art engagement in this new world be considered public health or social justice? It's really moved into that place. So values and strategies from other sectors are needed in the arts now more than ever. Now here's the trick. There are fewer jobs in the arts more than ever, particularly in nonprofit arts. Nonprofit sector in general, we know, is undercapitalized. So if you're moving into the work, kind of like Hawaii, it's not like you're looking for a job. You're actually looking at, what plot of land can I get so I can do something with it, build it, and do, you know, and make it something. It's that kind of entrepreneurial frontiers kind of mentality that we need in the arts from non-arts experts. Moreover, it is important that I think everyone in this room make it their 2043 their agenda. 2043 marks the time when there will be no majority ethnicity in this country. That means at 2014, we're already living it. And the importance of not just racial diversity, but the kind of psychographic diversity that we need, that will bring in the kinds of skills we want for our dying planet to become part of a lush future. That 2043 paradigm is deeply important. So if you yourself are, you know, currently somebody from the margins, or you're in a position to pull somebody up from that, it is important work, because I believe arts work is movement work. And that's how I roll with it. And so 2043 is all of our agenda.
Great. I would love to open the floor to questions now.
Sorry. So I live in a small community in California, and I'm working with a fellow artist who both of us are dreaming of doing kind of what the founder of Ashland did in Oregon. He wants to take this small little town and develop it so that way the backwoods, ignorant kind of folk, and that's generalization, sorry, so that way they can figure out a new way of opening their minds. And the problem is, well, how do you get an audience to do that in a very conservative portion of a state, of a small town? So honestly, this isn't about me. This is more about the challenge. You know, like you guys, you were just talking about moving to Hawaii and what would you contribute. You were talking about the challenges that you faced developing your art. You talked about taking away your ego. So what would you guys do to develop an organization in a small town to inspire with the arts? And I'm not just asking because, like, I'm going to steal it. I need help.
Well, two places come to mind. East Hawaii in Pahoa. The town of Pahoa is in the middle of the jungle of East Hawaii. East Hawaii is very tourist resistant in that it rains, but it's actually the kind of environment, it's known as the outlaw city. It's actually the kind of environment and economy where art does happen. Another example of that is in Tasmania, the Mona, which has become, so two things. In East Hawaii, there's actually a resort founded by artists 38 years ago. That has now continued to evolve, and it has become the economic anchor of East Hawaii in and around that a town grew. And the people that it attracted are artists and outlaw types. And, you know, just this last trip, I spent more time in exhibitions and in carnivals out in the jungle than I would have in the city. Art happens there. Similarly in Tasmania, that there are a guy came in, started a contemporary arts museum, and over the last 10 years, it has become the economic anchor of the town. There's something about the combination of what you're talking about. It's not a big city. It could potentially be a destination. There is a local community that might be partial to supporting it, and then something happens. So there are cases where there is an arts-centered economy in small towns.
Yeah. Have them do it with you. And that probably means talking to them and listening to them and hearing their ideas and sharing yours and slowly building something that together.
Yeah, I mean, you have to convince them that you're going to do this, that you're passionate about it, lobby for it, create a really strong business plan for it. What is the strategic plan? What are the ultimate goals? But a lot of community outreach is going to be really important. They may need this and they don't know it. They may be anxious about it or uncertain about it. And it's important for you to convince them that this is something that would be good for their community. You can't work at odds because then it'll never work. You don't need to go big right off the bat. Start out small. Five Ton Crane started in 2007, and it's been slowly improving upon itself and developing itself and evolving, because it's always an evolving process. So start out small. Community events, do some open houses, art shows, a couple, you know, theater in the parks, or, you know, and then slowly work your way into it, and people will become more comfortable with the idea, and you'll be able to identify who your intrinsic supporters of that are, because they'll start to identify themselves, and then they'll start to be voices for your idea.
Yeah, I think a theme that kind of gets back to what we've been talking about is, you know, kind of knowing your audience and knowing, I'm sure you already know many, many of the people in your small town, but, you know, kind of pitching this idea to them and finding out, okay, what do they think about it? What are the barriers to, you know, what are their hesitations? What are they anxious about? You know, are there psychological or emotional or like financial barriers? You know, what do parents think? What do moms think? Like, what do city council members think? Like, who are the kind of like, who are people who are gonna influence the rest of the community in kind of supporting this? So I think doing that research at the beginning is going to be really important. So yeah, don't have a solution, but I think that's probably a good place to start.
Another question? No, over there.
Okay, it's really hard for me to formulate this question. So the general topic is creative careers internationally. And I guess when you said that the art sector is dying, it kind of makes me think of, I mean, my impression of the arts here in the United States, or here in California specifically, is that there's not a lot of state financial support, and that big theaters are expensive and kind of unaffordable to a lot of people. And then I think kind of internationally, and I think of, I just went to Ireland this last summer, and the state funds their theater, and tickets are accessible, and they have a lot of support. So, and then that makes me feel tempted as an artist to pack up and go abroad and find maybe a career over there. So what, I guess, what are your thoughts on that? Or do you, would you recommend people going to places where the arts are more accessible, or building something where you are right now, if that person considers that place their home?
Okay. Both, I would say both. I mean, travel, go live someplace else. I lived in Greece for 3 months, and my girlfriend lived in Germany for a year and a half. And it's true, there's a lot more support in the European countries for the arts than we have here. We don't have a Secretary of Culture here. We don't have a lot of national support. There is some state support, but when you compare it against the work that they're doing in France and England and Ireland, it definitely seems like that we don't get as much support as we probably should. I mean, there's still a lot that you can do here, because we need more people in the United States who are advocates for the arts, who will support the arts, and who will build the programs that we need within our communities, because otherwise we'll just turn into this homogenous society, and we won't have that cultural diversity, that artistic diversity that we need. So
I think, to the extent that you could contribute to the arts, I think it would be very helpful for you to have experiences that you could take, and values that you could take from another place, especially one where, you know, I was just thinking about this in terms of state-funded work. I am dying to go visit lots of different parts of Scandinavia to listen to music, to find out why the hell is it that part of the world something per capita happens with music. There's something about being able to inhabit, literally, really inhabit a different reality, and then go to another place and be, in part, that's what it's like, what? Like, this is the arts? We could do so much more with it, right? Like, so if you came from, and I would recommend Australia, just because in the last year they quadrupled. An initiative happened and a law passed which quadrupled their arts funding. So I've been saying, maybe I should live in Australia and be in the Renaissance in that moment when it quadruples. What happens to a society when it quadruples and you have a Renaissance in an arts economy? My God, what can I learn from that? What can I learn? How can I get pleasure from that? And from that pleasure, what can I translate into the stuff that's needed maybe in the U.S.? Yeah.
I think we're lucky, too, to be living in the Bay Area. It feels a bit like a bubble. It's a really amazing time right now with the theater and the visual arts and the music, to be in the Bay Area and to be able to contribute to that is an incredible experience.
I think it also, I mean, I've lived in France and in Spain and traveled a fair amount, and it's true that governments support the arts much better. However, I also know that there are frustrations in all sectors of the arts in the European countries and in Australia as well, because they can't get the specific funding they need. It's never enough funding. There's limitations on the funding. So it's not a perfect, beautiful picture anywhere, I don't think. Maybe there is a utopia somewhere. And we also, I know this probably a really unpopular thing to say, but while we don't have as much government support, and we should, there are corporations out there who put a lot of money into the arts, and they have a lot of money, and they're the big bad guy. However, there are ways of getting that money, and you know, you look at any theater performance, music performance, art exhibit, every exhibition out there, and there are corporate sponsors. Mm-hmm. That's where the money is coming from.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, it's time to move on to our third panel, so please give a round of applause for our panelists.